you.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome to worship on this cold winter's day. It's good to be together in the house of the Lord, to be together as God's people. Please take notice of the book, the announcements in your bulletin today. After worship, the prayer community will be meeting. They're always looking for new members, so if you are interested, please join the prayer community in the gathering room behind the sanctuary. Monday afternoon, Presbyterian women will be meeting as well. And looking ahead, please note there is a deacons meeting on January 29th, and on February 4th, after worship, will be the annual congregational meeting. Also, not in your bulletin today, but the sympathy of the congregation is extended once again to the Clark family. Janet Clark, wife of the late Reverend Cree Clark, died on Thursday, the 18th, just a couple of days after we buried Cree and celebrated his life. There will be a visitation on Wednesday evening, that's the 24th, it's coming Wednesday from 4 to 6 p.m. at Second Presbyterian Church, where Janet was a member, and there will be a memorial service announced at a later date. That will also be announced when it is known. So once again, we extend our sympathy to the Clark family at this difficult time as they grieve not one but two losses. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us worship God.
Thank you.
confess our sin, then God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In faith, let us pray together. God, our Creator, we confess that we are broken, sinful creatures. You call on us to change our lives, yet we do not heed your warning. You give us good news to share, yet we remain stubborn and silent. Forgive us, God, of grace. Help us to repent and follow you, bearing witness to the good news that your holy realm is near. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Dear ones, hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn us? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone then who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. Hear and believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen.
Now, Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk. And he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on a sackcloth. When the news reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. Then he had a proclamation made in Nineveh. By the decree of the king and his nobles, no human being or animal, no herd or flock shall taste anything. They shall not feed, nor shall they drink water. Human beings and animals shall be covered with sackcloth, and they shall cry mightily to God. All shall turn away from their evil ways and from the violence that is in their hands. Who knows? Maybe God will relent and change his mind. He may turn from his fierce anger so that we do not perish. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he said he would bring upon them. And he did not do it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I
second lesson today is from Mark's Gospel. The first chapter, beginning at verse 14, Jesus here is taking center stage and calling his first disciples as his ministry begins in Galilee. Listen again to God's word. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Make us to know your ways, O Lord. Teach us your paths. Lead us in your truth and teach us, for you are the God of our salvation and our hope is in you all day long. Amen. What is it about the urgency of Jesus' message that causes these first disciples to respond by dropping their nets and leaving their lives behind in order to follow him? Jesus is taking center stage now here in Mark's Gospel. John the Baptist is in jail, and all attention is pivoting towards Jesus. The ground has been tilled by John. The people have been prepared. John's work now is finished. Now is Jesus' time to shine. The time is fulfilled, he says. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. Now that Jesus is back in his home territory in Galilee, his public ministry begins in earnest. He is one of a large number of wandering rabbis, these men who are going around preaching and teaching and trying to collect followers in this time in the ancient world. Many of those itinerant rabbis were preaching one of two messages, either against Rome, or they were trying to convince people it was the end of the world. But there's something different about Jesus. Instead of trying to marshal forces against the Romans to try to drive them out of the land that God has given to his people, Jesus is calling people to examine their own lives and to repent of their sins. Instead of talking about the end of the world, Jesus instead preaches good news, the coming of God's kingdom. Coming of God's kingdom. We don't know how long Jesus was walking around the Sea of Galilee before calling those four first disciples that we heard of this morning. Had they ever heard him preach before? Did they know anything about this Jesus who showed up on the scene? Had they heard his message before? Had they talked to him even? Mark and the other gospel writers make it seem like Jesus just sort of shows up one day. And he sees Peter and Andrew and James and John and he says, "Hey, come on guys, you can come be my disciples." And they drop everything and follow him. That's what the gospels make it sound like, but we don't really know if that's exactly the truth. If they just left to follow Jesus without much of a second thought. I have to admit, that's a tough pill to swallow. We are skeptical by nature, many of us. And so if somebody says, hey, follow me, and you've never met them before, most of us would say, go take a hike. That's not how we do things. But there's something about Jesus in this scenario. There's something about Jesus that is so compelling, so amazing, that these four men drop their nets and leave their boats and their father behind to follow Jesus. Not once, but twice in the passage that we heard this morning, Mark uses the word immediately. Immediately, Peter and Andrew leave their nets to follow Jesus. Immediately, James and John leave their father, their boat, and their hired workers to follow Jesus. Immediately is one of Mark's favorite words. He uses it frequently in his gospel. And here, at the beginning, there is a sense of urgency. There is a sense of urgency with this word and in the disciples' response to Jesus. This is not a situation where they sort of hang around on the periphery and try to gather some information about Jesus. No, these four men are immediately captivated. If they were teenagers, we might say they were head over heels. They're not trying to figure out who Jesus is or where he's from or even where he's going. Jesus awakens something in Peter and Andrew and James and John. He awakens something in them, a sense of meaning and life-changing purpose. And it compels them to drop everything and follow him. This deep sense of urgency overrides the need of Peter and Andrew and James and John to fully understand what is at stake, or even grasp who Jesus is. This sense of urgency is enough for them to step out in faith. Step out in faith. Jesus simply says, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men, fishers of women. And that's exactly what they do. They go fishing. Such is the urgency that they feel. There's all sorts of things that cause us to feel a sense of urgency. Maybe you want to get home in time to see your favorite TV show. Though with on-demand and DVD reruns and all of that, it's less stressful these days. Maybe you can't wait for a family member to visit or for you to go visit a family member. Maybe you want to see the Grand Canyon or the Eiffel Tower or the Great Wall of China before you die. Or maybe you just want to get to the store for that really great deal. A sense of urgency can help us get things done, though living with perpetual urgency is probably not all that healthy. There is urgency in Jesus' message today. The time is fulfilled, he says. In other words, the time has come. So let's not wait any longer. Let's go and proclaim the good news. This good news, at its core, is a message of God's grace. A grace that is rooted in love. A grace that refuses to leave us as we were. It is a grace that seeks our transformation by the power of the Holy Spirit. This good news is also a message of obedience. Drop your nets, whatever your nets may be, and we all carry around nets all the time with us. Drop your nets in order to follow Jesus and continue sharing this good news. And ultimately, it is a message of life or death, living in God's kingdom, living in God's presence, or perishing because we have turned our backs. We heard a bit of Jonah's story this morning in the first lesson, though it wasn't the really famous part of Jonah's story, the high impact, high energy, gets swallowed by a whale part of the story. Jonah reminds us of the power of God's grace that is rooted in love. The lesson that we heard this morning is the second time that God speaks to Jonah. And the second time that God speaks, Jonah listens. He goes to Nineveh, and maybe he sort of half-heartedly calls the city to repent. And the text says that even before Jonah can make it halfway across that exceedingly large city, all of the people do just that. They all repent. They believe God. They proclaim a fast. And everyone, great and small, puts on sackcloth. Mourning clothes they put on. And ashes. Even the king. And God, the text says, God changes his mind and doesn't destroy Nineveh. But there was that first time that God spoke to Jonah. And what does Jonah do? He turns and he runs in the opposite direction. Instead of Nineveh, he heads for Tarshish. And it takes a whale, or at least a really big fish, to get his attention. But even when Jonah does finally go to Nineveh, even when he finally does hear God's voice and obey God's command, even when he does go to Nineveh and the people repent, Jonah still isn't happy. He accuses God. He accuses God of being too gracious, too kind. I knew it, Jonah says, that you are a gracious God and merciful, that you are slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Jonah's angry because God didn't destroy the Ninevites. Jonah turns his back on God. And he goes off into the desert to pout in a little cabin. But even then, God protects the prophet. God causes a bush, a shrub, to grow up to give Jonah some shade from the harsh desert sun. But then God takes the bush, the shrub, away in order to teach Jonah a lesson about what is truly important, about the lives of people, even Ninevites, people who are created in God's image. And so there is grace for Nineveh, and there is grace for Jonah, and there is grace for you. Jonah is not the best example of obedience in the Bible, but he does ultimately obey God's call to go to Nineveh. Sometimes we resist God's call. Sometimes we head off in the other direction, headed for Tarshish instead of going to Nineveh. But God always has a way of bringing us around. Today, we ordain and install new church officers, men and women who've heard the voice of God speak through this congregation, calling them to serve. And they have responded in obedience. I am grateful for the hard work of the nominating committee, chaired by Deb Ryerson. And I'm even more grateful that they didn't have to recruit a whale to convince anyone in order to serve. Jonah's story and Jesus calling the first disciples is finally a message of life or death. The Ninevites repent, and God spares them. Peter and Andrew, James and John, they drop their nets and follow in order to find life in Jesus. The life that we have in Jesus as his disciples is life in God's kingdom. We're not left on our own. We're not not just left in this world to our own devices, but we become citizens of God's kingdom. And living in God's kingdom is a blessing beyond anything this world can offer. We are subject to the whims of human governments, as good and as bad as they may be. But in the kingdom of God, we are governed by the one who willingly gave his life for us on the cross. Jesus teaches us to pray especially for the coming of God's kingdom. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, so that God's will may be done here on earth, just as it is done perfectly in heaven. Paul says to the Romans that the kingdom of God is not about food or drink. That is, it's not about earthly things. But the kingdom of God is about righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. And in Revelation, we hear about the new Jerusalem. The new Jerusalem, the kingdom of God that has come in fullness. Where there is no hunger or violence or pain or suffering or sickness or jealousy or greed, but light and life in the presence of God. The kingdom is already here now. Jesus says so. The kingdom is here now, if we could just see it, and yet we are also waiting for the kingdom to come in its fullness. And so in the meantime, dear brothers and sisters, we do the work of the church. Like the first disciples, the urgency of this message compels us to step out in faith, to proclaim the gospel for the salvation of humankind, to shelter and nurture and provide spiritual fellowship for the children of God, to maintain divine worship, preserve the truth and promote social righteousness, and to be an exhibition of the kingdom of God, to be an example of the kingdom of God to this world. Such is the compelling and urgent message of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Oh,
There are varieties of gifts, but it is the same Spirit who gives these gifts. There are different ways of serving God, but it's the same Lord who is served. God works through each person in a unique way, but it is God's purpose that is ultimately accomplished. To each is given the gift of the Spirit to be used for the common good. Together we are the body of Christ, and individually members of it. We are called into the Church of Jesus Christ by baptism, and marked as Christ's own by the Holy Spirit. This is our common calling, to be disciples and servants of our Lord. Within the community of the Church, some are called to particular service as deacons, as elders, and as ministers of the Word and Sacrament. Ordination is Christ's gift to the Church, assuring that his ministry continues among us, providing for ministries of caring and compassion in the world, ordering the governance of the Church, and preaching the Word, and administering the sacraments.
Representing the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, the session of First Presbyterian Church now ordains Susan Palio to the office of elder and installs her to active service. The session also installs to active service those who have been previously ordained, Deacons Barb Allen, Mary Jane Glosser, and Elders Lynn Paparica, Linda Mann, and Charlie Thompson.
Ordination calls the whole church to renewed commitment and reminds us all to bear gladly the yoke of Christ given in the covenant of baptism. Let us therefore reaffirm our baptismal vows, renouncing all that opposes God and God's rule, and affirming the faith of the Church. This is for all of us. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior, trusting in his grace and love? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love? If so, say, I will with God's help.
I will with God's help.
Dear brothers and sisters, the grace bestowed on you in baptism is sufficient for your calling, because it is God's grace. By God's grace, we are saved and enabled to grow in the faith and to commit our lives in ways which serve Christ and his Church. God has called you to particular service. Show your purpose now, answering these questions. These are the constitutional questions that all who are ordained in the Presbyterian Church must answer, deacons, elders, and pastors. To the six of you, do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior? Acknowledge him head of all and Lord of all and head of the Church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. If so, say, I do.
I do.
Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be, by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the Church universal and God's word to you? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our Church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? If so, say, I do and I will.
I do.
Will you fulfill your office in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? If so, say, I will.
I will.
Will you be governed by our Church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and Spirit? If so, say, I will. Will you in your own life seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ Love your neighbors and work for the reconciliation of the world. If so, say, I will.
I will.
Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Will you seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? If so, say, I will.
I will.
This is the question for the deacons. Will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? In your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? If so, say, I will. And this is the question to the elders. Will you be a faithful elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in governing bodies of the church? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? If so, say, I will.
Do we, the members of the church, accept Barb, Mary Jane, as deacons, and Susan, Lynn, Linda, and Charlie as elders, chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? If so, say, we do.
We do.
Do you agree to encourage them, to respect their decisions, and to follow as they guide us serving Jesus Christ, who alone is head of the church? If so, say, we do.
We do.
Together then, with the whole church, let us stand and affirm our faith using the words of the Apostles. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Gather here, face the pulpit. And invite all who have been ordained as elders, or teaching elders, or ruling elders in the church to come forward for the laying on of hands. If you have been ordained, not if you're just currently serving, but if you've ever been ordained, please come forward. Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for your steadfast faithfulness to us. In every age, you have called forth leaders to serve you and equip them with your gifts. Among your people Israel, you anointed prophets, priests, and rulers. You called pastors and teachers, bishops, elders, and deacons to build up your church. With Moses, the 70 elders bore the burdens of the people, ministering in the power of your Spirit. Alongside the apostles, deacons cared for all in need and guarded the community's peace. In the church, deacons, elders, and pastors served together so that your whole people might be equipped for ministry and built up into the full unity of Christ. For your servants in every age, O God, and for the church of Jesus Christ, we give you thanks and praise. God of grace, pour out your Holy Spirit on Barb and Mary Jane, that they may be faithful deacons in the church. Give them openness to the Holy Spirit's leading, that they may see and serve wherever there is need. Train them in the school of prayer, that they may express the compassion of Christ for the poor and the friendless, the sick, the grieving, and the troubled. Equip them with courage to bear the gospel into the halls of power and to communicate your presence and might among those who are powerless. In everything, give them the mind of Christ, who did not grasp at greatness but emptied himself to become a servant of your reign. Give them joy in their walk of faith and a sure sense of your abiding presence for their work of ministry. God of grace, pour out your Holy Spirit on Susan, Lynn, Linda, and Charlie, that they may be your faithful elders in the church. Give them prudence and sound judgment, wisdom and courage to order the life of the church in obedience to your word. Nourish them in the life of the Holy Spirit, that they may exercise the ministry of discipline with humility and compassion. Guide them in governance on this session and in every court of the church, that they may be servant leaders, following Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life to set others free. Give them joy in their walk of faith and a sure sense of your abiding presence for their work of ministry. O God, through the waters of baptism, you have claimed us as your own and called us to share in Christ's ministry. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that we may discern the gifts you have given, calling them forth from one another, and together use these gifts for the good of all. In obedience to Christ and in the unity of his Spirit, may we proclaim good news, make disciples, be light and leaven, share our bread, offer a cup of cold water, and wash one another's feet. Make us strong in Christ to live as your people and show forth your saving love in the world by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Barb and Mary Jane and Susan, Lynn, Linda, and Charlie, you are now elders and deacons in the Church of Jesus Christ, and for this congregation, be faithful and true in your ministry so that your whole life will bear witness to the crucified and risen Christ. Welcome to this ministry. Eternal God, just as Jesus walked along the seashore in Galilee calling disciples, and Peter and Andrew and James and John heard that call and responded, O Lord, may we hear your voice calling. May we silence the noisiness of our lives so that we can hear you and respond in joy, respond in gratitude. Enable us, O God, to drop the nets that we carry in our lives, the anger, the bitterness that we carry, whatever might be holding us back, O Lord, the jealousy or the greed. Enable us, O God, to drop our nets so that we might be your devoted and faithful disciples following you wherever it is that you are calling us to go. Lord, just as they responded, enable us to respond, not with hesitancy, but to respond in faith and joyful obedience, that we might share the good news of your kingdom, the good news of your kingdom that has come near to us, that is here even now. Help us, O Lord, to see your kingdom, where there is no pain or suffering, where there is no anger or malice, your kingdom where there is no longer suffering, but where there is light and life. Help us, O Lord, to live faithfully into your kingdom, to be your kingdom people, O God, to work for the peace and justice that this world so desperately desires and needs. Lord, as we gather this day, we come into your presence and offer our prayers. You call us, O God, to speak to you, to speak to you our worries, our fears, our hopes, and our joys, and to offer to you, O God, all that is on our hearts and in our minds. So, O Lord, as we come to you this day, we bring before you, Lord, all of what we have, all of our worries, our joys, our fears, our concerns, all that we have, O Lord. We trust that you are at work in our lives. And we trust that you know what we bring to you even before we bring it. And that in the midst of all that we have, all that we are, O Lord, in the midst of all our messiness, that you can and you are indeed working in us and through us. As we gather this day, O Lord, we give thanks for new elders and new deacons, and for their joyful answer to the call to service. Lord, bless them in the days and weeks and months and years ahead as they serve you here in this congregation. Give them energy, O Lord, intelligence, imagination, and love to serve the people with joy in their hearts. Lord, as we gather this day, we lift our prayers, prayers for this world, prayers for those who are struggling this day, prayers for those who are living not in peace, but in the midst of fighting and warfare. We pray, O God, for peace, peace in Ukraine, peace in the Middle East. We pray for our own nation, for your wisdom, O God, to rain down on us, that we might realize so much more unites us than what divides us. We pray, O God, for our own community, for this place we call home, for this community and all that it means to us. We pray for schools, for students as they learn, and for teachers and faculty, for custodians and principals and school nurses. We pray for our children, O Lord, as they learn and grow and mature, that you would bless them. We give thanks for those who care for so many in this community who are struggling. We give thanks for Carlisle Cares and for Maranatha and for Project Share, for all the other agencies that are such a blessing to this community. Lord, we pray for our own congregation, for those today who are grieving, especially for the Clark family. Bless them, O Lord, and give them hope in the resurrection through Jesus Christ. We pray for Fritz as well, O Lord, for his healing and wholeness, and for all those many others who are struggling, Lord, whose names, whose faces we lift to you now. Lord, in all of our prayers, we trust that you hear us. And we pray, O Lord, that we would understand and hear your response. And in responding, may we give glory and praise to your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and power, and glory forever. Amen. We now have the opportunity to give back to God a portion of what God has given to us. The offering plates are at the doors and exits today for your use. Please take this time to consider your response to God's generosity.
Thank you.
blood is good, return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, and help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and remain with you always. Amen.
Very few people.